Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. And if, like me, you're in Australia, well, shouldn't you be in bed? Happy 28th World Water Day to you all. This year's theme, of course, is the value of water. That covers everything from equitable access to cultural and religious issues. But today's UN Global Compact Academy that you've dialed into focuses on the value of water to business. It's organized by the UN Global Compact CEO Water Mandate and the Water Resilience Coalition. Now, we're going to separate the session into two sections. First, corporate leaders from Gap Brands, Starbucks, and UN Water will discuss what water means to the business sector and why it should be prioritized in business decision-making. Then we'll introduce you to two practical tools to help companies advance water stewardship with examples from companies and others who have already used these tools. Now, you can ask questions at any time. We have experts on the line from the UN Global Compact and the Pacific Institute to answer via text, and we'll put some live questions to our panelists too. Please submit any questions you have using the Q&A feature. And you can also comment, react, and share your thoughts using the chat feature on your control panel. Today's session also has simultaneous translation into Portuguese and Spanish. To activate this, please click Interpretation and select your language of choice. Now, as for me, I'm an editor for Reuters Financial Commentary Division of Breaking Views. If you don't know it, I'll of course be happy to sign you up for a free trial. Now, our bread and butter is to cover Wall Street, big mergers, economic developments, things like that. But climate and water have increasingly become a central part of what we cover as investors, banks, and major corporations cotton on to the associated risks and opportunities. Unfortunately, on the whole, they're doing things far too slowly. Now, I do see some good developments. Mars, for example, has just, and by just, I mean like 5 minutes ago, joined Danone and Ingredion in the Ceres WWF Ag Water Challenge. And between them, they're committed to using sustainable agriculture and water stewardship practices on 1.2 million acres of farmland. There are plenty of other examples, but it's not enough in total. Now, Jason Morrison's going to come on in a minute. I'll let him cover other things, but I'll focus just on Wall Street. Check out the big banks' recent net zero goals they've all been publishing. I dare you to find a substantive mention of water among them, even though it's responsible for a decent slug of carbon emissions and financing resilience and adaptation are increasingly key. Investors too need to up their game. There's good published work coming out of BlackRock, DWS and others, but even BlackRock boss Larry Fink said not a word about water in his climate-heavy letters to shareholders and CEOs this year. Investors rarely put water-focused resolutions forward for a vote. Companies' annual meetings, and banks don't talk of ceasing finance to water insecure projects or companies in the same way as they have done with coal and Arctic drilling. Now, I do see signs of hope outside of Wall Street and corporations. The Biden administration has appointed some fierce advocates for water, not least Deb Haaland as Secretary of State for the Interior, Radhika Fox as head of water at the EPA. And let's not forget that one of the authors of that BlackRock piece on water was Brian Deese, who is now a senior advisor to the president. And water finally has a place at the top of the table at the next COP meeting later this year, we hope it's later this year, with Kate Lambert of CDP leading the charge. But mostly, I'm afraid, water is still undervalued and under serious threat. But don't just take my word for it. I'm now going to pass the baton of doom over to Jason Morrison, president of the Pacific Institute and head of the CEO Water Mandate. Over to you, Jason.
Thanks, Anthony. My job today is to ring an alarm bell, and I'm going to use a suite of global data sets to paint a picture for you. But let me start with one of my favorite water-related quotes that speaks to this year's theme of world valuing water. And that's from the famous American Benjamin Franklin, who said, "When the well's dry, we know the worth of water." And many companies have long understood that water is not simply an abundant, low-cost input. They've recognized that not having water can have serious material risk for the business. They've also recognized that being a waster of water or a polluter of water can affect the company's legal and or social license to operate, particularly in water-stressed regions or droughts when water supplies are acutely scarce. Unfortunately, as Anthony mentioned, few of these leading companies have a clear understanding of how climate will impact their water systems in regions that are important to their business. But this perspective is oriented toward those that already have water access to it. It's a so-called value at risk perspective. What about the worth of water for those that don't have it? UN Water recently published a stock-taking exercise reviewing progress against our water goal within the SDGs. And the report finds that 2.2 billion people lack access to contamination-free water in their homes when they want it. That's the new standard under SDG 6. And 55% of the world's population lacks access to safely managed sanitation service. In order to achieve our ambitions on these two SDG targets by 2030, UN estimates we'll have to quadruple our pace of current progress. And amidst a global pandemic, it's startling to think that 3 billion people around the world don't have hand washing facilities with soap in their homes. A few years ago, UNICEF estimated that women and girls spend 200 million hours a day fetching water. 200 million hours a day fetching water. If you were to compensate these women and girls $5 an hour for this work, that would be $1 billion a day in income. But this is, of course, foregone income because women and girls aren't being compensated for this water collection work. And the opportunity cost for girls is even higher because fetching water often comes at the expense of going to school, which in turn precludes getting the education that will eventually allow for a job as an adult that can ensure financial security. This single issue is one of the root causes of generational cycles of poverty and gender inequality. The story for nature is just as bleak, if not scarier. Over the last 50 years, scientists estimate that population sizes of aquatic species have declined by 83%. And over that same stretch of time, we've lost 35% of the world's wetlands, and perhaps 90%, scientists estimate, over the last 300 years. Just a quick ecology review. Wetlands are important to humans because they improve water quality by removing surface water pollutants, especially by sediment trapping, nutrient removal, and chemical detoxification. Wetlands also play a key role in stormwater management and flood mitigation by slowing down and assimilating stormwater. In terms of biodiversity, the IUCN found that of the near 30,000 freshwater-dependent species assessed for their so-called red list, over a quarter, 27%, are threatened with extinction. And of course, two of the main drivers for this pressure on biodiversity are degraded water quality and habitat loss. So in sum, mismanagement of our natural systems has significantly diminished our capacity to maintain biodiversity, to improve water quality, and to mitigate flood risk for humans, all of which nature currently does for free. Now, some of you may think I'm just painting a doom and gloom picture, and you're right, I am. This is a seriously dire situation. But my biggest fear, and the one that keeps me awake at night, is that the public in general and decision makers specifically don't appreciate how fast climate change is going to impact our water systems. Climate scientists within the International Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, predict that climate change is likely to increase the frequency of droughts in presently dry regions by the end of the 21st century. And while drought frequency is going to be projected to increase in many regions, it's particularly pronounced in regions where water reduction is also projected. In other words, in places that are already water stressed, we're going to get drier on an annual average basis. And then the frequency of droughts is also going to be increasing in those regions. It's now projected that 700 million people could be displaced globally by intense water scarcity by 2030. And on the too much water side of the equation, IPCC predicts a 20% increase in the size and a 200% increase in the frequency of very heavy or rare rainfall events. These storms could double the number of people at risk of flooding. Many of you will have heard the often cited statistics that 9 out of 10 natural disasters are water-related. The climate statistic you're probably not aware of is that 1.4 million Texans were still facing water disruptions more than a week after the mid-February storms in Texas that wreaked havoc on the state's power grid and water services. And of that total, more than 20,000 were completely without running water because of water main breaks, mechanical failures, frozen or broken water lines. But these recent winter storms in Texas are a case in point. How many water resource managers in Texas had this scenario in their risk matrix? It's just one example of the connections between climate change and the impacts on water security that few are anticipating or are prepared for. I could list dozens more had I more time. Now, the good news is that building resilience is not just the right thing to do, it's a smart thing to do as well. According to the Global Commission on Adaptation, investing $1.8 trillion this decade in developing early warning systems, water resilient infrastructure, and nature-based solutions could generate $7.1 trillion of net benefits. Also good news is that leaders are starting to emerge that understand the imperative for us to do more on water faster. They recognize the need to elevate the ambition and accelerate the action to build water resilience in the face of climate change. That perspective is in the DNA of the Water Resilience Coalition, a flagship initiative of the Sea Water Mandates that was launched 1 year ago today on World Water Day. A cornerstone of the WRC is the recognition that no one organization can tackle the global water crisis alone. There's an imperative for collaboration to really have scalable impact on improving water security and resilience in these stressed regions. The collaboration taking shape amongst coalition members, but also with their civil society and public sector counterparts. We see this as the only way forward, and we hope that others will join this nascent initiative. Back over to you, Anthony.
Great. Thank you, Jason. I'm glad to see I'm not the only one with both a bit of doom, but also some positive takes on what can be achieved. Now I'd like to hand over to the Executive Director and CEO of the UN Global Compact, Sander Ojiambo. Sander, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, gentlemen, and greetings to everybody here. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you may be in the world. So, ladies and gentlemen, business leaders and friends, we're meeting today, as we know, the 28th World Water Day, because we know and we believe that water is a key driving force of economic growth, of dignity, of health and well-being, and actually of overall societal well-being. But yet, as we've already heard, and we must recognize, there's still a lot more to be done individually and collectively to ensure that we're protecting water and preserving the environment, because the two are inextricably linked. And also the links to human well-being and quality of life, as Jason has so vividly and aptly highlighted in his comments, is very important. We've talked about the cost of water for those who do not have it and the impact of water stress on nature and climate. The impacts on climate change that we've seen are first and foremost felt through water, from drought and flooding to extreme weather events. And that is why our session today builds on the twin pillars of the UN Global Compact Strategic Plan for 2021 to 23, the Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Climate Agreement. The future for all of us depends on making rapid progress to safeguard water supplies and promote sustainable environmental change. We know that this past year has been marked by tragic loss. Yet in the midst of this pandemic, there is also the opportunity to shape COVID recovery plans that emphasize water solutions and define a more sustainable path for future growth. This is not only a requirement to spur equitable economic recovery, but it's fundamental for the health and well-being for workforces, for communities, and for economies. Equitable access to water, sanitation, and hygiene are also key drivers of gender equality, as we heard earlier. So today on World Water Day, we explore how companies can contribute to water stewardship and play a leading role in addressing the climate crisis, contributing to both adaptation and mitigation efforts. And if they join together, we are certain that businesses of all sizes can certainly magnify their results and the impact. However, if we fail to act, the growing problem of water scarcity will cost billions. Last year, prompted by the need for urgency, the UN Global Compact CEO Water Mandate launched the Water Resilience Coalition. This initiative mobilizes business leaders to address global water challenges through quantifiable commitments towards building the resiliency of 100 water basins worldwide. And through collective corporate action, the coalition aims to provide sustainable water access, sanitation, and hygiene to 100 million people by the year 2030. This coalition also complements our Business Ambition for 1.5 Degrees campaign, which calls on companies to commit to aggressive emissions reduction targets to limit the worst impacts of climate change. So today, on this World Water Day, we call upon companies here to join the Water Resilience Coalition and commit to helping us solve the world water and climate crises. By joining the coalition, you can showcase your company's leadership, championing access to water for all, and united with other businesses in the business of a better world. Now to close, here are some of what our participants are saying about the important work of the Water Resilience Coalition. Thank you.
We're at a moment in time in terms of determining the kind of world that we want to build. If we want to build a just, equitable, inclusive, and sustainable world, we each need to think about the role that we can play in this. And what I can tell you, having worked on water for the past 10 years, is that water leadership is required.
Global leadership from companies is essential to address the water crisis. The Sustainable Development Goals demands this.
Well, the Water Resilience Coalition was really designed to get a group of leaders together and help forge a path, because we really do need to do this collectively.
We've pledged to accomplish three large initiatives by 2050. Make a net positive water impact. That means we'll contribute more to water-stressed basins than what is taken from them. Develop and implement a water-resilient value chain across our own global value chain, and provide global leadership, raise awareness, and inspire other industry leaders to join this important cause.
We have to come together to realize that corporations have a powerful platform, NGOs have a powerful mission, and if you bring those things together, we can create powerful outcomes.
The climate crisis is a water crisis, and business has the potential to have a significant impact to address it. And I believe business has not gone far enough yet. So we need to step it up and make a real difference as we think of our impact through 2050.
It's very important that all of us understand water's role in our business. We have historically taken this for granted. All of our processes were basically built upon the premise that water is going to be plentiful and free forever. That was true for about 100 years. It's not going to be true going forward. And so understanding that relationship is going to be absolutely vital to all of us.
The issue of water resilience isn't just an environmental issue. It's a business issue. The issue affects every business in every industry. Even if your own operations aren't directly affected by water stress, your supply chain probably is. We must act now, and we must do it together.
We're very proud to be part of this coalition because we see the challenge, and we think it's really important for businesses like ours and others to take specific action, commit to bold goals, and deliver a sustainable impact on reducing water stress on the planet.
It is thrilling, imperative, and necessary that the WRC is elevating access right now in the time of the pandemic, because we can accelerate resilience and ensure health for the long-term benefit of the communities and the world in which we live.
Well, thank you, San, and thank you for doing that video for us as well. Some great comments from some big leaders there from corporates around the world. Now let's kick on with our first panel. And if I can ask our panelists to come onto the virtual stage, we've got Kellyanne Naylor, who's the Vice Chair of UN Water, Michael Kabori, Chief Sustainability Officer for Starbucks, Mark Breitbart as well is joining us. He's the President and Chief Executive of Gap Brand. Welcome to the three of you. Thanks for making the time.
Thank you.
So I think I'm going to I think we've all agreed that you'll make a couple of minutes of comments. So I'm going to let you, Kellyanne, kick off with any opening statements you want to make.
Great. Thank you so much. And it's really great to be here as we celebrate this year's World Water Day on the theme of valuing water. For those of you who don't know, UN Water is the platform through which the United Nations system and its partners come together to coordinate our work on water and sanitation. And we bring together 70 UN agencies and international organizations that are all collaborating to address these global water challenges. As Jason mentioned, the latest data is very clear. We are not on track to achieve our water and sanitation goals by 2030. In the SDG 6 progress report that UN Water published in early March, we found that some of the areas that are off track need to quadruple our rates of progress to be successful. And this is coming at a time where, you know, we're looking at 2030. We now have 10 years to reach these goals. But as we've already heard already, that the water and sanitation crisis touches every aspect of society, whether it's economic, it's social or environmental, and water underpins so many of our development objectives. And of course, there's also a great impact on the sustainability of the business sector and communities that the business that the businesses serve. So really, at this time, we think that business also has a key role to play in bringing the sustainable solutions really to scale and ensuring that the true value of water is resources, bringing together the government, civil society, and the UN system. So to do this, the UN system has developed the SDG 6 Global Acceleration Framework, which we launched last July at the High Level Political Forum. And this framework really helps us focus on a key set of accelerator areas. These are the real game changers that we think are needed for the sector, and the actions of the business community are critical for all of them. For example, we really need to scale up innovative practices and technologies. We need to mobilize more and better targeted financing. And we absolutely need to generate and share more and higher quality data and information to guide policy and decision making. Our aim is really to help use this accelerator framework to unite our global efforts to solve the water and sanitation crisis in countries. So these transformative opportunities can only be possible with the joint leadership of the business sector. So I'm so excited to be here today to learn and exchange with you about how we can accelerate progress on water and sanitation. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Kellyanne. Now let me pass over to Michael. Go ahead, Michael. I think looking at Starbucks in the news recently, we've seen obviously the news about the company wanting to halve its water use in green coffee, I believe it is. Tell us a bit more about what's going on.
Well, thank you so much, Anthony. It's a pleasure to be here. And as you pointed out early on, we all know that we're in a climate crisis. And today on World Water Day, happy World Water Day, it also happens to be my birthday today. So I know that our audience, I know our audience understands that we're also in a water crisis, which is inextricably linked to the climate crisis, as we heard from Sandra and as we heard from Jason. You know, Starbucks, in 2019, we completed our water footprint. And that understanding of what our water footprint was inspired our CEO, Kevin Johnson, to announce that longer-term aspiration for us as a company to become resource positive, to give more than we take from the planet. And for water, as you mentioned, that means that by 2030, our goal is to conserve or replenish 50%, half of the water we use in high-risk river basins. We're also going to be reducing our carbon and waste footprints by 50%. And as you know, those are both inextricably linked to water. To achieve those strategies and targets, we are focused on five key actions that we're going to be taking as a company. One is on agriculture, of course. We know that coffee, other beverages, and dairy comprise 57% of our total water footprint. So we're going to be supporting and expanding practices like precision agronomy that are climate and water smart. Second thing we're going to be doing is expanding the plant-based menu options that we know are better for the planet. Number three and four actions that we're taking focus on waste. Number three is about reducing food waste, which, of course, we know has embedded water in it. And number four is about reducing our plastic waste that shows up in watercourses and oceans. We know we need to shift away from the single-use cup to reusable packaging. And the last action, number five, we're going to take is greening our operations. So designing new water-efficient equipment and expanding our leading Greener Stores program across all 30,000 stores in Starbucks fleet across the world.
Great. Thank you, Michael. If you're born on World Water Day, what else are you going to do with your life? Well done for choosing the right path. Now, over to you, Mark, from Gap Brand. Tell us what's going on with Gap at the moment, with Gap Brand.
Thank you, Anthony. I just want to say thanks for having me here. Really excited to be here with such a great group. Nice to reconnect with Michael, who has just been such an influence in our whole industry, and we've taken many lessons from and I've known over the years. So it's good to be here. And, you know, we know that the climate crisis is an us problem. And we also, you know, we talk about how it affects business, and businesses need to do a better job of understanding how it impacts their supply chains. And we know that it's so critical for our business. Not only do we fundamentally believe it's a human right, but we know that that in our supply chain, our business is so incredibly dependent on water. Cotton growing regions are in high water stress areas, and you know, the well-being of people who make our products, the majority of whom are women, is part of why how it's so critical. Jason, in his opening remarks, mentioned the amount of burden that falls on women and girls in the water crisis. And we know women face a disproportionate burden. And part of our commitments are specifically targeted towards helping women. So we know we cannot have a healthy functioning supply chain if we don't take more action. And we're taking many steps to reduce both our water use and also support communities to ensure that we have a more sustainable future regarding water security. So I think, you know, some of the things that I'll point to that we're launching today, just in honor of World Water Day, but have been commitments in works, new goals to empower 2 million people to improve access to drinking water and sanitation by 2023. You know, in the spirit of wanting big goals over long periods of time, but also having goals within a shorter period of time. So it's nice to have a 2023 goal. We are in partnership with USAID Women in Water Alliance. So we're partnering to help villages and local governments develop and implement water plans, working with water.org to provide microloans for items like water hand pumps and water filters, and training cotton farmers on water stewardship with a partner institute for sustainable communities. So the commitment is deep. We understand how grave the situation is, and how important it is for us as humans, but as a business, which I know is what is we're tying together today. So thank you, and I'll pass it back over to you, Anthony.
Great, thanks, Mark. I'd like to kick off actually starting with you, Mark, because some of what you said there is really very interesting. Actually, Michael, you sort of touched on this as well, and obviously, Kellyanne, this is one of the main focuses, I think, what you're looking at. But in thinking about how you integrate water into decision-making, you've obviously had to think a lot here, Mark, about things like, you know, where women fit into your supply chain, into where the products come from. That's a very different decision for companies to be making, it seems, compared to the past. I know you've been talking a lot about the partnerships you've struck to do that. Is that the best way you've come up with doing it? Is there stuff that you've done on your own as well? I mean, how does this manifest itself into what you're doing on the ground? Is it just? These are very big steps you're taking with these partners you mentioned, Waterdog and WaterAid and others. But I mean, how did you get to that point? Considering that you as a company, it really does take a rather different bit of thinking, doesn't it, to what we usually see as what companies in the West would think about.
Yes, I mean, I think it's a great point about how we actually integrate water into the decisions we're making day to day. And we know that we impact a huge number of people. When you think about the people we impact in our supply chain, whether it's, you know, over 100,000 employees, or multi-millions that are in our footprint that are dependent on our company, or our reach to consumers. That's a consumer brand that can reach consumers and that with conviction can change consumer behavior. We factor it into into many of our decisions. I think we have people who care deeply. We need to give them tools to help make decisions. So, you know, for example, we have a wash well program in denim in some of our jeans that uses 20% less water. We've used this and saved 400 million liters of water. And over 90% of our jeans are now in the wash well program. We've rolled it out to the other brands in Gap Inc. So that is part of what we need to be doing. We need to work with our mills, work upstream the supply chain, and then ensure that the teams are constantly exploring options to save water. Another piece is that we have are launching today a group called Generation Good. It's a collection of jeans making and tees using the least amount of water possible, but we also have a good list that goes beyond water. So it's about waste, materials, emissions, and support for workers. So, you know, I think these are the kinds. I think people want to do the right thing. I think the teams have it, and it's about us making sure we have the right partnerships and the right tools for them to be able to, and also permission to make this as much of a, you know, it's like as much of a mandate as anything else in the bottom line. So that's hopefully gives you some color.
Great. Yeah, thank you. Michael, over to you. I mean, this must be giving you huge amounts of deja vu, considering that until about a year or two ago, you were at Levi Strauss. Do you have any comments based on what we were just discussing about, you know, how companies have to think about these factors that normally we think companies wouldn't think about? But also, let's move on to what Starbucks is doing. What's unique about the goals that Starbucks is pushing towards at the moment, would you say?
Well, Anthony, I mentioned the things that we're doing right now to focus on reducing the amount of water we use. But as you and our audience know, any water strategy needs to go well beyond that, right? It has to be very holistic. Not only do we need to address conservation and replenishment, we also need to be looking at water quality, water access, sanitation, and hygiene, as well as overall ecosystem health. And so for Starbucks, you know, I really wanted to focus on two of those things that we look to the Water Resilience Coalition for support with. One is access, sanitation, and hygiene, and the other is ecosystem health. So as we've heard from, you know, Jason and Sandra and you, Kellyanne, water absolutely is a fundamental human right. But, you know, this is not just focused in the developing world, right? Water access, sanitation, and health is an issue right here in the United States. We've all heard about Flint, Michigan, but it's also an issue in places like the San Joaquin Valley, which is literally an hour from where I am right now in Berkeley, California. And we know that these issues impacts fall disproportionately on women and girls in the developing world and on BIPOC communities here in the United States. So for Starbucks, one of the core aspects of our sustainability work has to be environmental justice. Second thing I want to mention is ecosystem health. And we've mapped our water footprint globally, and Mark referred to, you know, some of those high-risk water basins. And so we've been working with WWF and others, and we know that there are six major Tier one, as we would call them, water basins where we operate and we source our products from. And they're probably common to many of you, right? In North America, it's San Joaquin, Mississippi, and Rio Bravo. And in Asia, it's the Daugherty, the Mekong, and the Yangtze. And we know that one company alone cannot possibly hope to address the issues we see in an entire river basin. And that is why we're so excited to join this WRC and the work that we're doing. Because with companies like the Gap and the other 18 major multinational companies that are part of the WRC, we can begin to make an impact at the basin level.
Great. All right. Thanks, Michael. Kellyanne, over to you. I mean, this must be what you're hearing here must be music to your ears. I mean, often I look at these things and I think that these are social benefits that companies don't often know how to monetize somehow, or at least how to appreciate it will help them. And you mentioned the SDG6 and accelerator, and I think you basically explained what it is. But can you tell us quickly, what have you seen so far that the platform has done? Have you seen? Is it too early to say there's been best practices from certain companies or certain governments? I mean, what are you seeing so far?
Thank you so much. And if anyone had any doubt, I was in New York. I just had a bunch of fire engines going by. So apologies if there's background noise. But yeah, I just really, Mark and Michael, thank you so much for sharing those inspiring examples from your countries. And I think really showing how valuing water can create impact along your value chains and also really contribute to environmental justice, human rights, and all of these values that we see with water. So as I mentioned, we have this SDG 6 Global Acceleration Framework, and it really is intended to help us in the spirit of the sum of the whole being greater than the sum of the parts. How can we bring together different communities in this international setting to be able to focus on these accelerator areas and tackle the key bottlenecks? And really what we're looking at is what are those building blocks, if we get them right, that we can achieve the maximum impact and accelerate progress. So we have identified 5 accelerators, and those accelerators are financing, data and information, capacity development, innovation, and better governance. So I think, first of all, before going into a couple examples for the business community, I wanted to say that this framework has the support from the highest levels of leadership and governments across the UN. And for those of you, I know not everybody's watching UN TV, but if you were following it last week, the president of the General Assembly held a meeting, a high-level meeting on water, that really demonstrated that political will is extremely important to accelerating progress. I think the second part of the framework that's exciting is that it's being driven by country demand. And we know that this local level progress will be the primary measure of our success. And that's where these transformative changes will happen for people. So far, we've had at least 84 initiatives as of Friday that had been registered in our SDG 6 action space that really show how we're coming together collectively to create that progress. But really quickly, 3 examples I wanted to share. That I think the first thing is that the business can really help with investing in water-saving measures, whether we can be reporting and sharing data, advancing water stewardship together with communities are just some examples. The next one that really stands out to me is innovation. And one of the things we hear coming up again and again from countries is that over half of the world's population does not have access to safely manage sanitation. And we hear over and over again from countries that wastewater management and the opportunities for water reuse are a major challenge, but also an opportunity where innovation can play a key role. So this is just one of the examples where this can happen. And just last but not least, my favorite accelerator is capacity development. And I think that our success is really going to depend on the people that we can bring into this challenge and all of the businesses. You are attracting talented, creative, solution-minded professionals. 3/4 of the jobs in the global workforce depend on water. So private sector really has a key role to play also in building capacity in your businesses, within your workforce, and the communities that you work in to strengthen the water sector. So these are just a few ideas. Of course, there's many more, but I think we can really together use this acceleration framework to leverage our partnerships and really advance our collective efforts on the global water crisis. And as many of you know, today we launched the UN World Water Development Report on valuing water that can be a key resource. So we really hope to be able to work together to build this more water secure future now and faster. So thank you so much.
Excellent. Thank you. I'm going to stick with you on this one. We've got as you can see, I'm very technical here. I've got WhatsApp here for the questions. So one person here is asking, actually the question I would have loved to ask, how are companies engaging in policy and I suppose governance issues, as you mentioned, as part of the SDG 6 accelerator, at the basin level, which is the root cause of so many issues in water? And I see it here in Australia since getting here a few months ago. I mean, the disputes over the Murray-Darling Basin are intense. The Colorado River in America, I mean, seven states plus Mexico, it's crazy. South Africa, Cape Town. Who was looking at, who was in control of the water, who was in control of supplying the water? There was completely different governance issues at play here. Can companies get involved in this, Kellyanne? I'll ask you that quickly, then I'll pass to Mark and Michael on that one and see what they think about where companies get involved, if at all, on policy and governance.
Great. Thanks so much, Anthony. That's a great question. And I think what we see emerging is really that solving this crisis does really require a multi-stakeholder approach. And I think that we all of the different elements, the business community, civil society, governments, there isn't one sector that's going to be able to solve this crisis. So what we do see is increasingly governments and countries putting in place multi-stakeholder platforms that are able to bring together the different skill sets, different resources to be able to tackle these problems. And one concrete example that I'm familiar with is in Nigeria, where in my day job, I'm the head of UNICEF's global program for water, sanitation, and hygiene, and also support UN Water as a vice chair. But this work that's been happening there has been really exciting. We've been putting together the work of construction companies that are building toilets, companies that are working on circular economy solutions for the management of human waste, together with a global drive to end open defecation. And I think these are the types of partnerships. Another example is, of course, with COVID-19. We've worked together with the World Economic Forum to develop a COVID action platform on mobilizing hand hygiene for all. That is also very much part of the WASH pledges with the Wash for Work initiative to be able to try to scale up water and sanitation. I think coming down to the basin level, and again, one of the things that we really see is the need for increased water cooperation, also as a way of mitigating conflicts between local communities. And so this work at the basin level to be able to share data and information, to be able to find joint solutions, eliminate inequalities is really an important part of making an inclusive and resilient development future. So these are, I think, some good examples. And obviously, the work of the Water Resilience Coalition is very much contributing to developing these types of new approaches that integrate together the work from these different stakeholders.
Great. Thanks, Kellyanne. Let's pass that over to you first, Mark. Policy and governance issues. How does a company get involved in that, if at all? And you can't avoid it, but it's kind of not your thing either. So how do you deal with it?
Well, we have so many challenges that impact our business that rely on us to partner with both our sustainability team, our government relations team for when it comes to policymaking, and especially partnerships. I mean, you know, not to push the problem back, but this is part of where the WRC comes into play. We know that we are going to be stronger if we partner with other companies and with partners in our supply chain. So, you know, if there's more we can do in India, we know there is. We partner with a mill and a strong partner in India, Arvind, to work on a new water treatment facility using circular design approaches, saving hundreds of millions of gallons of water. We think that we have to be involved on numerous fronts, and we have strong relationships between all of these, whether it's government affairs on policy or sustainability on traceability measurement, you know, all the way to what we would like to be able to impact consumer. When we talk about like Kellyanne mentioned, capacity development, when we start actually getting out to a consumer, our ability to open capacity becomes even greater. So I think that we have, you know, the WRC, we can all work together and have a greater impact than any of us and any of our companies will have on our own.
Great. Thanks, Mark. And quickly, Michael, any thoughts from you on governance and policy issues?
Absolutely. I would totally agree with Kellyanne and with Mark. This is an area where companies together can have a very powerful voice. Starbucks recently joined Ceres, which, as you all know, is a network of companies that take policy positions, not only on climate, but water. And Ceres has a campaign in California called Connect the Drops that has over a dozen companies, including The Gap, and they work with California legislature to actually pass in 2019 a bill around a water fund for disadvantaged communities. So it's a great example of what companies getting together can do to really impact the and influence the policy process for the betterment of people who are impacted by the water issues that we're talking about.
Great. And look, very quickly, we're basically out of time. I want to ask one more question, which fits into a few of these things. Each of you, just very quickly, how can we raise awareness? Again, this is from one of the listeners to the webinar. How can we raise awareness about the fact the water crisis is real for stakeholders, whether people, businesses, investors, who sit in a place where they think they have abundant water? Now, having covered this for a fair bit, my initial reaction will be, well, read the papers, watch the TV and see what's happening around the world. But that's me being a facetious journalist. What would you, in a rather more diplomatic way, say to that about how we would get people to pay more attention and realize it needs to be done? Kellyanne, I'll start with you on that one.
It's a good one. I think it's one that we are all struggling with, but I think it is about making it really a human issue. And I think making it, and I think the point was made earlier, that it's not one that's just affecting, you know, some people somewhere, but it's really something that's affecting all of us. And I think one of the things we're trying to do with UN Water and with the work that I do in UNICEF is get young people involved in this early as champions. And also as a way of building up public support and awareness. So that's one of our tactics.
Perfect. Mark, what do you think?
I think continuing to raise our voice on these issues and as we launch things like Generation Good or Wash Well in Jeans and explain and give context and some background as to why it's important. I do think that it's coming to a city near you. I mean, if you know, as we mentioned, Flint or we mentioned Houston, that it's so much closer to home. And I think just continue to raise our voice. I think we would like to make sure that when we're marketing styles, we address all of the properties and why. To Kellyanne's point, I do think younger generation is more dialed in, more tuned in. So I think amplifying their voices will also help with this. But I think business plays a key role. When business says, is this really critical to our bottom line, that this is incredibly critical to the future of the company and the future of all of the people who are our stakeholders, I think we will be able to have an impact. So you need to continue to share what we know and the things we're doing about it with the level of urgency that we have.
Perfect. Thanks, Mark. I think I'm going to steal that idea of coming to a city near you for my next Ask Claw campaign. Now, obviously, the final word has to go to the birthday boy, Michael. What do you think about this? You've opened yourself up for this. Come on.
Okay. Anthony, I think that if climate is the global tragedy of the commons, then I think water is the ultimate local tragedy of the commons. And Jason opened this session with a quote from Benjamin Franklin. I think of another quote from Benjamin Franklin that is not quite so nice. And he said, "We must hang together, or surely we will hang separately." And so we got to work together on this. Thanks, Anthony.
Well, there's an upbeat way to end it. But yes, I mean, you're absolutely right. Look, thanks all three of you for coming on and sharing your thoughts. Absolutely fascinating. And Mark, especially thanks for sharing some of the new actions you're announcing today. Kellyanne and Michael, fantastic comments too. Thanks very much, all three of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now we've kept him waiting long enough. We're going to head over to basically the second part now of the session. We're going to get Emilio Tenuta from Ecolab to talk to us and give us a demonstration of the company's Smart Water Navigator tool. Emilio, many apologies for keeping you waiting. Over to you.
Thank you, Anthony. It's great to be with you all today. As Jason and the panel before me have stated, the disparity between water supply and demand will continue to increase if nothing changes. And that's why action at the local level is critical to achieving your water goals. And businesses today are increasingly aware of this risk that water scarcity poses to their operations. While many companies have set ambitious goals to address these concerns, a gap still exists between good intentions and actions. And last month, Ecolab and Sustainability News and research organization GreenBiz surveyed 93 companies with revenues of at least $1 billion. Here's what we found. 65% of the respondents said that corporate teams are responsible for setting water goals, and 95% said that the responsibilities for achieving them are at the local level. But get this, nearly half, 45%, lack the measurement and digital tools to accomplish these goals. So I'm pleased to be with you today to talk about a new platform that can help address these disparities. Ecolab's Enhanced Smart Water Navigator is a free, publicly available online tool that can help businesses achieve their water reduction goals and very importantly, ensure continued growth. It offers a proven methodology to help organizations bridge the gap between corporate goals and local action. It leverages the upgraded functionality of earlier iterations of Ecolab Smart Water Navigator and Water Risk Monetizer tools with additional new features to guide companies on their journey towards smart water management. Here are two very important opportunities for users of the tool launched today. First, it enhances a company's understanding of water risk and guides a response that is proportional to the problem. This includes ensuring that action takes place at the local level, which we know is where it needs to happen. Second, it helps industry build trust and credibility with stakeholders to drive more effective engagement in governance and collective action. Collective action, as you know, is essential because water is a shared resource. So the challenges and solutions must be shared as well. Before we continue, I'd like to share a short video about the Enhanced Smart Water Navigator and how it can help businesses become more responsible water stewards. Please cue the video. Thank you. As described in the video, the Smart Water Navigator will help you along each step of your smart water journey. For sites that haven't established water targets, they can use the Smart Water Navigator to identify risks and can then develop a plan using the guidance and resources within the platform to begin to take local action. For sites that already have water targets, they can also use the Smart Water Navigator to determine where their targets are and, you know, are they sufficient enough to effectively manage the shared water challenges at the local level. They can access industry best practice guidance on how to implement and track progress toward meeting those targets. The tool walks users through the smart water journey based on four steps, as you heard. The first step is to identify the role water has to your operations and quantify water-related risks in financial terms. Next, users can set meaningful local water withdrawal targets for facilities to manage water use risk using the latest WRI water stress data. Once local water targets have been set, the Smart Water Navigator provides users with a practical, industry-specific guide to implement solutions that will improve water management practices at the facility level. And in the final step, users can track their progress over time and revisit the smart water action plans to make adjustments based on changing conditions. With the help from industry experts and organizations like WRI, S&P TrueCost, TNC, and BlueRisk, we have added additional features to the Smart Water Navigator. For example, you can compare water use efficiency across a portfolio of sites or against industry averages to prioritize water initiatives. The tool also helps you identify a sustainable water withdrawal target to maintain operational stability and preserve water basin health. And very importantly, it also enables you to evaluate site progress over multiple years with a plan, do, check, act approach to stay on track so you can hit your water withdrawal target. We all know that collaboration is the key to a successful water stewardship strategy. And the Smart Water Navigator will help you to that end with two very important outcomes. First, it will help you build a roadmap to optimize water use and proactively manage risks and impacts to address shared water challenges and increase basin resilience, which is what we heard from the panelists before us. And second, it also builds the foundation for engaging with local stakeholders and credible and in a very credible and straightforward way. This will help establish trust and provide companies with a stronger social and legal license to operate. So in closing, I'd like to add that while the current freshwater deficit projections are somewhat daunting, we can change this trajectory. A smart water navigator can help by enabling executives, sustainability leaders, and plant and facility managers to work together and take action based on a practical roadmap with clearly identified solutions and practices at the facility level. That's good for business and also good for the planet. Now, let me introduce Peter Schulte to share some of the latest developments with the Water Action Hub.
Hi, I'm Peter Schulte from the Pacific Institute and CEO Water Mandate. I lead the development of the Mandate's Water Action Hub, a free online collaboration and knowledge sharing platform for water. I want to talk a bit today about how organizations can use the hub to collaborate on and scale their water projects around the world. I also want to give a sneak peek into some exciting new hub features slated for release in 2021. I'll start off with a tour of the hub as it stands today. From the homepage, wateractionhub.org, you can search our entire database of projects, organizations, resources, and lessons learned. Launched in 2012, the hub now features more than 1,500 projects from over 1,000 organizations around the world, with roughly 30,000 page views and growing every month. We like to call the hub a dating site for water and climate partners. From our global map, you can explore hundreds of water and climate projects and organizations and filter by country, SDG target, organization type, industry sector, types of services offered or sought, language, and more. That helps you find exactly the type of projects and potential partners most relevant to you and your organization. The hub even suggests potential matches for you based on your location and interests. On the map, you can also toggle on river basin boundaries and water stress data overlays developed by World Resources Institute's Aqueduct tool to see the state of water scarcity, water pollution, and water access. This helps users understand relative water stress in different areas, prioritize where to act, and understand what type of action may be most valuable. On a specific project or organization profile page, you can dig into much greater detail, such as project updates, measures of success, progress to date, key challenges addressed, partner organization, project members, lessons learned, and more. If you're interested in learning more, you can use the Hub's messaging system to get in direct contact with representatives from the effort. The Hub doesn't just connect water partners to one another. It also helps scale good practices and lessons learned. Any organization can author a lesson learned in the Hub, which will then be shared with all other projects and organizations working in relevant locations or on similar topics. This helps ensure that water and climate efforts everywhere can benefit from past insights and successes rather than starting over with every new project. Coalitions such as the Mandates Water Resilience Coalition or the California Water Action Collaborative can also use the Hub to coordinate internally. The Hub allows partners within coalitions to privately share locations or topics of interest with one another before they share these details publicly. The best part of all, everything on the Hub is available entirely free of charge. We want as many businesses, NGOs, government agencies, academics, and others to use our platform as possible. We even have members of the Hub team available to assist you in using the Hub and setting up your profile. This overview has just scratched the surface of what the Hub can do. If you want to learn more, send us an email at contact@wateractionhub.org. Next, I want to share a few details about a suite of self-assessment tools that will be launched and integrated into the Hub in 2021. Combined with all the functionality I just presented, they will be known collectively as Water Action Hub 4.0. These new tools have been made possible by Microsoft, whose generous support is enabling access to data that improves water stewardship decision-making by businesses. Powered by CDP data and advanced in collaboration with CDP, these new tools will offer companies insight into their water performance at the enterprise level, as well as specific recommendations tailored to each company. They complement other tools like Ecolab's Smart Water Navigator that generally focus on assessment and guidance at the facility level. Now, here's a short video about these upcoming tools.
Water, our planet's key ingredient for life, is increasingly a source of deep uncertainty for our society, our economy, and our ecosystems. Within the next 30 years, exacerbated by a changing climate, estimates by the UN see up to 5 billion people, or one out of every two humans, living with clean water scarcity. Envision a different future, a world with river basins able to consistently supply the high-quality fresh water needed for communities, businesses, and the entire ecosystem to flourish. To build this water-resilient future, we need to be good stewards of our water resources today. Yet at present, the private sector has no complete view of stewardship best practice. While the world is facing a projected 40% shortfall in fresh water supply within 10 years, 44% of businesses have no plan to address water risks. The Water Resilience Coalition is working to change that. Launched in early 2020 by seven global corporations as a new initiative of the UN Global Compact's CEO Water Mandate, the coalition set ambitious goals. Our members commit to net positive water impact by 2050 and embedding best practices across global value chains. To drive progress across all business sectors, we are developing a common language around water stewardship. The newly developed Water Action Hub 4.0 spans the assessment, insight, and action continuum of achieving water resilience. To start, a user completes a short self-assessment. The process is straightforward, and even more so if you previously completed the CDP Water Questionnaire, making use of existing data. The assessment results provide a holistic view of a company's water stewardship compared to peers. Next, the tool illuminates where and how a company depends on water. Like carbon emissions, water impacts are calculated for direct operations, energy consumption, and material inputs, or scope 1, 2, and 3. We know for many companies, the most challenging water use to address is in the supply chain. In response, our tool will help you prioritize how and whom to engage with regards to water in your supply chain. Finally, practical actions are pulled from a curated library of solutions, including pertinent case studies from peers, existing water tools, and collective action projects to improve water stewardship where it matters most. Measurable progress to achieve the UN Sustainable Development Goals on water is possible, and understanding your stewardship performance and potential for improvement is an important first step. The new tool provides an enterprise-level assessment of water-related maturity, and no matter whether a company is leading or lagging, provides new insights and actionable recommendations for your stewardship strategy. Together, we can lead the way to achieve global water resilience.
We expect a first iteration of these tools to be launched in the summer of 2021. Until then, we'd love your thoughts and feedback on how to make this effort as intuitive, relevant, and impactful as possible. To get updates and early access, please reach out to us at contact@wateractionhub.org. Thanks for listening and have a great World Water Day.
Well, thank you, Peter, and thank you, Emilio, as well. Those are great introductions to those tools. Now we're going to move on to our second and final panel before closing remarks. And I'd like to ask our two panelists to join me. That's Faith Lawrence, who's the country coordinator in the Natural Resources Stewardship Program in South Africa for Germany's GIZ, which is the Deutsche Gesellschaft für internationale Zusammenarbeit, if I may just show off my very rusty German. And from some small company called Microsoft or something or other is Paul Fleming, who's the water manager. So if we can have those two join us, that'd be fantastic. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. I've already forgotten the time zones. Thank you both for joining us. I'm guessing it's pretty early on the West Coast for you there, Paul.
Indeed.
So let's dive in. I think if both of you have got any opening comments to make, let's do that. Faith, I'll start with you. Anything you want to mention after seeing those presentations?
I mean, maybe just to say thanks for inviting us to be part of the session. We, as GIZ Natural Resources Stewardship Program, we've been a strong advocate of water stewardship for a number of years, and we definitely support the idea of shared tools and resources that could really bring credibility to stewardship journeys around the world, and especially in the areas where we work on water stewardship. And for us, I'm quite excited about the Smart Water Navigator tool that was mentioned earlier, especially because it's really about industry-specific guidance and really bringing credibility to a process of stewardship that many new companies entering into the stewardship space has not really may not necessarily have the kind of experience and resources to reflect on their own water journey. The Water Action Hub for us as well as a repository of case studies and tools and really of projects that are engaging in water stewardship and multi-stakeholder partnerships is also quite an exciting resource. And we definitely have been supporting the different development stages of the Water Action Hub. And we're definitely committed to continuing that because of the value that it brings to promoting water stewardship and credibility in multi-stakeholder partnerships, which is often a big challenge for companies working at catchment or a stewardship platform level.
Great. Thank you, Faith. Over to you, Paul, with your initial thoughts.
And Anthony, I just wanted to note that I know that the parts of Australia are experiencing severe floods here on World Water Day. So I hope you and your family are safe. At Microsoft, we made a commitment in September to be water positive by 2030. And for us, that entails to both replenish more than we consume at the global scale, while focusing that work in water-stressed basins where we have operations, as well as to enable access for 1.5 million people in 7 countries where we operate. But an important aspect for us as well is how can we deploy our products, our platforms, to help drive the resolution of these global water challenges and the global water crises. And that's one of the reasons that really drew us to participate and collaborate with companies such as Ecolab, as well as to work with the Water Action Hub. And that tool in particular is of interest to us because water is a connector, right? It's not just a sector, it's a connector. And data is also really comes to life when it's connected with other data. And we see that both of these tools provide that opportunity to collect, bring together, aggregate data, and enable companies to draw insights and glean insights from the compilation of that data. And so we're really excited about both of these tools and their ability to address water issues at the enterprise scale in the case of the Water Action Hub stewardship tool and at the facility level through the Smart Water Navigator. And we believe that this can help advance the field of corporate water stewardship by enabling, again, the gathering and collecting of data and generating insights that can drive positive change.
And obviously, when you looked at these tools, and taking you're looking at it from the point of view of a company which has been involved in this for a while, how do we get, are these tools well-placed for companies that haven't looked at stewardship before to come in? Do they need other background information before? And how do they think through this? I mean, it's great to think they can open up a tool and get going. That sounds fantastic. But how are there things that they need to learn first? Are there other issues that a company coming to water issues and water stewardship would need to get to grips with before even getting onto one of these tools? I'll put that to you first, Faith.
So that's a very good question, because when companies consider a water stewardship journey, of course they need to know their own water usage and they need to understand their own context. But where the tools become useful is that it enables a company, a new entrant into a water stewardship space, to try and understand where they fit within the continuum of a water stewardship journey. And the self-assessment tool, I think it would be really invaluable, because it enables a company to reflect on exactly where they're located, and also to see whether they're lagging or whether they're leading, and also find ways in which they could then start to engage in their own water stewardship journey at a local level, at a catchment level. And for us, it's really at that point where a self-assessment tool becomes quite interesting, because part of water stewardship is also to look at beyond the fence line activities. And when you understand your own water usage, but also you reflect on the context within which you find yourself, you then need to be engaging with other companies, other stakeholders, communities, policymakers who are also active in the same catchment or area where you, or site where you're basically active. And it is at that stage where your water stewardship journey becomes an interesting one. And for many, also a complex one, because for the first time, many companies would have to look at a collective action approach to maybe the shared impact on drought on a particular region and engage with a government ministry or a local government or local authority where they have not really had the opportunity to engage with before, but they require that relationship to ensure that they, there's water supply assurance for future operations. So the water stewardship journey really enables a company to really locate where they are and to try and support the mapping of an action plan that will enable them to look at water security in this broader context at a local level.
Okay, and Paul, over to you. Obviously, I started off that question saying as a really big company looking at this, and it's back to you. So how do you look at this as a big company that probably had more work on this, and then looking at how newer companies that haven't looked at water so much can come in and use these tools?
Well, I mean, I think they're a good entry point for companies to engage on this topic. And, you know, I think first step is to start, right? And, you know, I think any tool is not going to be a panacea, right? But they are an opportunity to start that engagement. And so I think that they provide practical entry points for companies who may be new to the space. Obviously, it's going to take some staff time, right? You need to have people who can engage and use the tool. Having some access to your, maybe it's your utility bills or your telemetry data, what have you, will be important as well. But we got to start. We all have to start somewhere. And I think these tools offer that opportunity for companies to engage. And I look forward to where this is going to go next. I think that we also have some work to do to help increase the visibility into what are the basin conditions in which companies operate. Obviously, Aqueduct, the water risk filter from World Wildlife Fund are useful tools. I think we can go further as a group of companies to help improve visibility into what are the basin diagnostics in a given location, what are the shared water challenges that need to be addressed, and to do this in a way where individual companies aren't necessarily doing this work and repeated left to right by a number of different companies, but rather how can we collectively create that shared understanding of what these water challenges are that is fundamental to taking collective action.
Yeah. And actually, I mean, it's interesting, actually, and thank you for asking about how things are going down here. I'm lucky in Melbourne, we're away from the floods. A lot of rain, but no floods. But that does bring to mind, you know, just think what's happened to Australia in the past couple of years. You've had, let's put the pandemic to one side, you've had massive floods this year, massive drought, and wildfires last year. That is something that a model can't necessarily come to grips with. And the same thing, if I look at the Colorado River Basin, I keep coming up with the same two basins, I think, on these calls. But that's very hard to get one's head around, and certainly coming to this new, the idea that you could be faced both with more shortage, but also more of a deluge, often within a short space of time. That's got to be something that the collective action you're talking about is useful, but even here, I don't see it. Water is such a big issue down here in Australia. I don't see that coming through quite enough yet. And what else do you think is needed? Is it just more and more talking, more and more collaboration?
I mean, I can just respond, I think each context is different. And I think what's important is when we talk about collective action, we need to understand the local conditions and the local context within which the company finds itself. And for us as practitioners in the water stewardship space, we really understand the value of not only understanding local context, but also understanding how other countries or other projects with similar drought challenges or water security issues have dealt with similar challenges. And for us, the Water Action Hub provides that. The case studies provide a very useful resource to learn about what's happening in Australia, in California, in the Pangani Basin in Tanzania, in whatever's happening around Lake Naivasha in Ethiopia. So the platform really learning from the experience of other countries and similarly challenged crises is already for us a very important starting point. And I think it takes away the anxiety, if you want to call it that, of trying to start a collective platform from scratch. And it allows one to draw the lessons quickly and then proceed to a very targeted, localized action based on a particular challenge and crisis at the local level. And I think maybe just to say one other important point is that it is not just about talking, it's also about trying to understand how decisions are made at catchment level, trying to understand how the system of water governance works and where you as a private sector partner or as a multi-stakeholder platform fit into a broader context of a complex context where immediate results may not be seen through a collective dialogue, but where long-term sustainability action could really contribute to supply assurance over a longer period of time. But that requires engagement with policymakers, with communities, with other water users and different stakeholders active in the same catchment or water basin area.
Right. Paul, over to you.
Yeah, the point you bring up is exactly why water needs to be at the heart of our climate response. You've described the whipsaw effect of tacking from floods to droughts and back and forth. And that's a phenomena that is what we can expect under climate change. The water cycle likely to be amplified, more intense, longer droughts, more intense floods, and tacking back and forth potentially between the two. And so this is again why we need to integrate water into our climate discussions and to ensure that if we are going to build a resilient future, that we need to take this comprehensive approach to responding to the climate crisis. And I think that this is in some ways another reason why collective action is so important, is that we, as we look to address these issues in a basin through the Water Resilience Coalition, and we have 8 basins that we're focused on this year, and we'll be expanding that going forward, we need to take a comprehensive approach and to ensure that we're making the investments that are directional to the shared water challenges that exist at the basin scale, and that we're thinking about the future and preparing for this future. The past is not prologue necessarily under climate change. And so as we take collective action again, in a concerted effort, left to right, with companies and civil society and governments, we need to be preparing for this more erratic water cycle in order to achieve resiliency at the basin scale.
Right, excellent. I know both make very good points there. Now, stepping back a bit, I mean, what advice can you give to companies coming into this space now, maybe from some of the issues that you faced, either Microsoft or Faith with you on the companies you've been advising? And actually, Faith made an interesting point already about governance, about dealing with policymakers. And actually, that was a question that came up on the first panel. So, Paul, I'll throw this one to you first. I mean, what kind of barriers have you encountered that you think are worth bringing up for those coming to the space now? And you know, governance is one of them. How do you deal with governance issues as a for-profit company?
Yeah, well, having worked in government before and specifically for water utilities, I think they tend to be hesitant to really want to kind of share the vulnerabilities of their system. So I think part of this is to have honest and candid discussions about what are the concerns with respect to water in a location where you're going to operate, and really understand those and have a transparent and candid dialogue with the hopefully the intent that your contribution in a basin can ultimately help to address what those key challenges are. I think some of the other barriers are, you know, water is typically very inexpensive from a pure cost perspective, right? But as the work that Emilio has led with the Smart Water Navigator and the Water Risk Monetizer helps to do is to reveal the true cost of water. And so I think the you may need to be prepared to not be able to pencil out from a ROI perspective projects that are going to address water issues from a pure cost perspective, but it's important to think about them from a broader comprehensive risk perspective, be it physical, regulatory, or reputational risks. And then I'd say another issue that is a barrier is, as I think Michael noted earlier, water is local. And that means in order to take informed and salient action, you really need to understand the local conditions. And that's a tall order, right? To really understand what's going to happen at the local scale, what the conditions are, takes a fair amount of effort. And I think this is, again, another one of the positive components of the WRC is how can we not only take shared collective action, but how can we develop a shared understanding of what the key water challenges are, key stresses are at the local scale that we can all benefit from, and that we all don't have to sort of write our independent reports that we can use to inform our actions.
Great. Thanks, Paul. Over to you, Faith, for a quick final word on your thoughts.
Maybe just to say I fully support what was just said. I think the whole point of shared understanding, a transparent process, but also understanding that for us in terms of our partnership work as well, the whole idea of building local capacity at the governance level is also quite an important starting point. And part of that journey would be to also get the private sector to understand how decisions are made at a local level in terms of how resources are being allocated and how catchment-based action is being prioritized in terms of water quality issues or water supply assurance. So for us, there are different points of entry, but also building a transparent process, a credible process, and trying to understand what that would mean at a company level, but also at a collective multi-stakeholder platform level would be very important critical actions that could start to really assist partners to unravel some of the challenges that they face with water security at a local level or at a catchment level.
Great. Thanks for that, Faith. And thank you, Paul. Thanks for coming on and sharing your thoughts with us. Now we're going to wrap up. We've got the closing remarks coming in a second. Just before I go on to that, I just want to say, please check out the chat for resources from today's session, as well as a feedback survey. We'd love to know what you think of today's session. And now I'll hand over to Doug Baker, Chairman of the Board of Ecolab, who you may recognize from his not quite cameo appearance, but from his appearance in the video earlier on in the session. Over to you, Doug.
Thank you. Hopefully you can see me or I'm and hear me. I'd like to just offer a couple of thoughts. First, thank you to the UN Global Compact, the CEO Water Mandate, and the Water Resilience Coalition for the opportunity to speak today. This is a great session on a number of levels. It clearly made the point clear that we have a significant water crisis. It's a planetary crisis, it's a human crisis, and ultimately it's going to be an economic crisis. There's nothing we make that doesn't take water. And every one of the companies here relies on water in a material way. And the realization that we have is we certainly have responsibility as business, one, to make sure that we get health in order, but two, we have this collective capability. And I thought Faith and Paul in the last session made this point incredibly well, that together we can do a number of really watershed, a convener, if you will, of all those who come much this specific resource. So what we really want to do is we want to move from where we are today. We launched a year ago the Water Resource Coalition. The idea is to get the top 150 companies who collectively influence over a third of the water consumption in the world. And by doing that, we think we can make a material difference on what happens going forward. Today, we've already got 20 companies on. Starbucks announced today that they're joining the coalition. Happy birthday, Michael, and thank you. And I would also say that importantly, as we go forward post-COVID and drop this more aggressively, I think we can have outsized impact. So what we really want to do is invite you to join. So look, either through the UN contract, the CEO mandate, call me, or whatever path you want to take, joining the Water Resource Coalition, we think is an absolutely vital stake in turning the tide of the water crisis into one where we're actually getting in front of it as of chasing it. So with that, I will say thank you. Thanks for this program. I thought it was extremely helpful. Anybody get any of that?